another of our special guests brings us back into the realm of the economic and achieving sustainable economic growth with a minimum of 7% GDP growth per annum. That's a sizable goal. Now, who better than the senior deputy governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, Dr. Nandalal Weerasinghe, to address this particular topic.
Good morning, everyone. First of all, the members of the distinguished panel, the members of CMA and other invitees. First of all, let me thank CMA for inviting me to this important event and share some of the ideas, especially on the theme of achieving sustainable economic growth with a minimum of 7% GDP growth, as already mentioned by our moderator. It's a challenging task. So let me share my views on that. Before I start, you know, talk about this, what we call trying to achieve 7% sustainable economic growth, real GDP growth. And let me just share with you the last 10, 12 years performance, whether we have been able to achieve sustainable growth in that kind of a rate. So it's based on the available data. So I have this chart which explains, starting from 2003 onwards, I think I will classify three different regimes with reasonably moderate growth, then some high growth, and the recent lower growth. So this is not necessarily the regimes on an political administration basis. It's basically purely on the economic basis. So if you look at the recent, you know, performance of Sri Lanka's real GDP growth that we are talking about 7% here, 2003 to 2010, in that period, we have been growing on average 5.9%. So it's about almost 6% during that 2003 to 2009, about 7 years, including 2003. So that tells us, in one caveat, this is all numbers compared by, not by central bank, it's by the Department of Science and Statistics, independent government agency which compiles GDP growth data. So we have had about 6% in the past, on a bit of a sustainable basis for about 8 years. I mean, that is good for a developing country like Sri Lanka. You know, there's a lot of developing countries at low growth, low per capita growth, should be able to grow at this rate. Then we look at 2010, 11, and 12, just after the end of the war, and there are 3 years, we had continuously more than 8% growth. On average, it has been 8.5% in those 3 years based on the latest available numbers. So we have had this 8% growth for about 3 years, soon after the end of the war. I mean, that's a major structural change of this economy that we are experiencing in Sri Lankan economy. But it has not been sustainable. So we are here talking about sustainable economic growth. So we had 3 years of more than 8% growth, but we could not sustain. Then if you look at the rest of the period, from 2013-14 up to 2018, about, say, next 6 years, average growth has been 4.3%. So why the 6% first period to a certain sustainable level, and then we came up to 8%, but not sustainable only for a short period, and we had a lot of other balance of payment issues, other fiscal high, fiscal deficits, all the issues were there during that period. So we had to apply brakes. And then we came to a low level of economic growth of around 4% for last 6 years. So this is, in this environment, now we are talking about how we can achieve 7% growth on a sustainable basis. So we never had this in the past. Even if you look at last, say, from 2000 onwards, let's say last 20 years. So then what are the issues? And this is where it is important for us to understand from current around 4%, for us to achieve 7%, it's almost double the growth on a sustainable basis, not 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, but on a continuously high sustainable basis, like Korea, Singapore, those days, and like in Malaysia or the Taiwan, even China, even now India experiencing, on a sustainable long-term basis, how we can achieve 7% growth. This is a challenge. Then the question comes, what are the issues? What are the structural issues? Why are we not, and how we can, it is, I would say, it is not impossible, it is possible. But we need to identify the issues, and then we need to address those issues. So in the current context, I would say the for us to achieve sustainable long-term economic growth at around 7%, I think the key, kind of a necessary condition is to what you call have overall macroeconomic stability. If I draw up an analogy, also with my general explanation, from the economic point of view, the foundation for the sustainable economic growth is macroeconomic stability. That is only the foundation. We need to have a good foundation, but that is not necessary. It is not sufficient. It is necessary, but not sufficient. That's why if you hear my boss, Gan Kumaraswamy, in all the forums talking, we have now make some progress in achieving macroeconomic stability in terms of what we call macroeconomic stability is we have lower fiscal deficits, we have lower current account deficits, we are going to earn more foreign exchange than what we were earning earlier. So what the key macroeconomic imbalance we had for last, say, 70 years is the fiscal twin deficit, fiscal deficit and this translate into current account deficit. We have been running large fiscal deficits, about 7-8% of GDP. Now we come down to about 5%. As a result, we have debt to GDP about almost 90% of GDP. And as a result, current account is almost a large deficit historically. And we are trying to bring it down to around 2%. Now still we had about, say, in those high economic growth period, then 8% growth, we had current account deficits of 8%, which is not sustainable. That's why we had to apply brakes. So what we are talking about here is it is necessary to have a macroeconomic stability as a foundation for growth. But that is that if we build up this foundation and we allow growth to take place, we'll still grow around 4-5%. This is what we call potential growth if we don't do other structural reforms to enhance our capacity or capability to grow at a higher rate. So that's important to understand. The analogy is that you build a foundation, but the pillars of that building are structural pillars that we need to build up. A part of the foundation, one is the macroeconomic stability from the economic point of view, and as Major General explained, the security is other strong, stability of security is other important pillar or foundation. It's not a pillar, it's a foundation. That's why even the example is that even advanced countries which have had strong macro and security foundations, even after they grow into advanced level, high income, still if you break that foundation, you could fall into a different situation. For example, 2008 global financial crisis they break up the financial stability pillar of that foundation, financial stability of the foundation. So then you break up the building, you can't grow, then you fall into a crisis. At any stage, you need to ensure that you continuously maintain macroeconomic stability, that is necessary condition. Then let's identify what are the other pillars that we need to build up on this foundation for us to grow at a higher rate. So let me look at why Sri Lankan economy cannot, at this stage, we are growing at around, we may be able to grow at 4-5%. There may be short-term fluctuations and some security issues, all these things like what happened 21st April is another example of if we had a good security foundation, and so that foundation was broken by that incident, and now we are experiencing a downturn. So that is the example of why we need a foundation. Then pillars are the systems that would ensure that will not happen again. We need to maintain that foundation, and we need to build up pillars so that foundation would not be destroyed or broken. So if you look at Sri Lankan, if you look economic growth point of view, what are important factors are, you need labor to grow, you need capital investment to grow, and you need productivity. There are three main factors of production: labor, capital, and productive employment, productivity. So if we don't improve all these things, if we not improve those things, then obviously we can grow around 4-5%. So now here we are talking about how we can achieve 7% growth. So let me take some of the issues that we need to address in medium to long-term basis for us to increase our capacity to grow. If you look at one key factor, is the labor. So labor is the one that creates income and create economic growth. If you look at Sri Lankan labor force, 16% of labor, people who are working, working age population, are working at the public sector. This is, I think, a world, one of the highest ratio of the public sector versus private sector ratio. I'm sure Professor will tell Singapore public sector number of employment probably 2-3%. It's a highly efficient economy. We have 16%. I don't mind public sector working. It's obviously less productive, we all know, less productive than the, because of the, it's not, I'm not blaming any public sector official, it is the system. You don't have sufficient incentive for you to be more productive under the public sector system of employment. There's no incentives, there are no bonuses, no performance-based promotions, all are basically is kind of what you call principal agent problem. That is a problem in the system. If you have 16% people working in the public sector, it's productive, and compare a lot of other countries, only 3-4%, and other 10% would be in a much more productive employment. So it obviously affects the productivity employment. I'm not, these are long-term issues. Then you look at the female labor force participation. So one issue that we are telling, we have unemployment is pretty low. It's about 4%. Overall unemployment is 4%. And but still, that's why a lot of sectors you find in the economy, even emerging sectors, you can't find people who are willing to work in these sectors. For example, now let's take construction sector. Construction sector people who did business know how difficult it is to find skilled labor in the construction sector. Even the hospital aid sector, tourism sector. If there is no incident like this, tourism has a great potential. If we are to grow tourism by 20% each year, and do we have sufficient skilled labor and who are people who are willing to work in the tourism sector in this country? They also find it difficult. But you may find a lot of, large number of graduates who are unemployed and who are not willing to work in this sector. This is exactly the Singapore professor's analogy. So we have certain sectors. For example, if you look at plantation, we don't have sufficient labor to have productive output in this sector, because a lot of people are moving out of the plantations. And if you look at construction sector, you can't find skilled people, sufficient people to have this sector on a competitive basis. Even if you look at IT BPO, recently there was a survey, need for graduates of IT BPO mismatch is huge. But we don't have sufficient skilled labor sectors that we have advantage. Even the tourism sector, as mentioned, we don't have people. But if you look at accountants, like what this institution are generating, I think we are the highest per capita accountant, someone told me, in Sri Lanka. But do we, and also public sector, if you ask any youth in this country or graduate from a university or graduate from a school, high school, they want a public sector job. In addition to this 15% working, they also want to join the government at a relatively lower paid, low productive employment. So how do you address that? This is where I think what professor's example is good for Singaporean economy, where this very high technological and advanced economy. And in our case, I think what is important is that we need to develop skilled labor necessary for the sectors that can that can take off, looking at the comparative advantage and resource of this country. This is, I think, what is important, the structural reforms. If we don't do that, I don't think any sector would be able to. So what is other countries are doing? For example, in Singapore example, I take construction sector. Today, Singapore is a small city with huge, large number of tall buildings and very developed city. Did they develop this city in constructions using their own labor? I don't think any Singaporean, very few Singaporeans are willing to work in the construction sector. What they did, if they can't find people to work in this sector, they allowed labor migration in a proper way. And they brought in labor from Indonesia, Bangladesh, all these countries, and they allowed them to develop the construction sector in a much more competitive way so that they are cost effective in developing that city. But here in Sri Lanka, what we find, even the plantation sector, we are very reluctant to open labor market for migration. But in the market, in a situation like that, informally, that is already happening. You can see a lot of Chinese labor and some of the labor coming here illegally working. Even in the paddy cultivation in some of the eastern province districts I was told, there are Indians coming with tourist visas and working seasonal employment on this. Otherwise, they can't generate this output. So why don't we allow that kind of lack of skills or low skill labor, which is necessary to sustain some of the industries? Let them come in informal way and let them work and formally go without having illegal all these things. But that's a huge, that with governments willing to open up the labor market for even the Singapore pre-trade agreement, when there was no clause to professionals coming, still there was a big debate by some of the trade unions that we are going to open up this one for professionals flooding in. That's all misperception. I think this is where mismatching the labor force is one important thing that we have to ask. Other one is also look at the aging population. Sri Lanka is no longer not generating large number of working population. We are aging population. We are moving into aging. In the future, there will be more people in the who cannot work. There will be less amount of people who can work. Probably people who will have to work harder, they will have to pay more taxes for the expenditure that now incurring now. So that's another challenge, is the aging population. And then other factor is the female labor force participation. So I'm sure Singapore, the female labor force participation must be much higher. We are 35%. Female who can engage in gainful employment, only 35% are in the workforce. Why not at least another 20%? So we have still huge labor mismatches. But female who are in the working age population are sitting at households and housewives and not engaging in gainful employment. So what are the issues there? So you need to address this. One is the, as Singaporean professor again explained, how come a housewife gain a skill, enhance her skill to be prepared for enter into a workforce? Why not all these skills? Why people can't achieve those skills? Why that's again a provision of skills? Those are not only for the graduates, so young people, even at every stage, as he mentioned, Professor mentioned, even at the age of 40 years, there should be a mechanism or facility or environment. A 40-year-old female should be able to gain some skills and enter into the workforce. Otherwise, we open up the labor market or we will still grow at a 3-4%, because that is a big constraint here. So these are the important medium to long-term reforms for us to achieve the what we call 7% growth. And then look at the structure of the employment, the other important issue, which is, if you look at the contribution to the economic growth, agriculture contributes to 7%, industry 28%, services other about 59-60%, so that's 100%. So 7% of the agriculture, the share of the economic generation by agriculture sector only 7%, That sector employs 28% of that working age population, the workforce. So the 28% of the our labor force making only 7% contribution to the economy. But there are certain other sectors who are struggling to find people to work in the much more productive sectors. So why we not have a system where the first thing is to improve the productivity of agriculture. If we produce 7% share of the GDP, at least they can employ 10-15% of, because this agriculture is anyway, unless mechanized, it's a less productive sector. Let's say 15% is given to the agriculture sector. How about attracting, converting those agriculture labor in the villages, rural areas, so at least 10-15% to improve their skills and make them to be able to work in the services or industrial sectors. There's no kind of a system, mechanism for them to gain on their own skills that it requires. And even if you look at the three-wheel drivers here, there are a lot of youth are doing an easier job with the three-wheel driving. Why can't they become a technical person with some training, become a mason, carpenter, welder, the mechanic, this are our tourism sector. They obviously can earn much more than even the public sector. You know, this development officers, fresh graduates, 40,000 graduates the government is going to recruit is given maybe 15,000, 20,000 rupees. But this technical skill person now can earn 100,000 rupees a month if they have right skills. Why not all this abundant or less skilled labor have a system for them to? Without that kind of system, I don't think we can go for 7% growth. So you need to reallocate resources and allow this. In fact, our labor, the primary and school level education, we are on par with any other country. Even I would say Singapore, school education is par with any other country. So our primary education is superb. But after that, people who go out of the school system, then only 20,000 or 25,000 can go to the universities, still at the expense of you all taxpayers' money. And what they are generating, not large number, science, technology, English and mathematics, is that's why a lot of pressure for the government to is arts and other graduates, and there's no technological knowledge, no technology, no English, no mathematics, and they are under pressure for the government to employ them at the public sector. So taxpayers have funded their education up to university, and after the university still they are unemployable, large number of unemployable, then government will have to, again, taxpayers will have to pay for their employment, less productive employment. So this is where I think the Singapore Institute of Technology, unfortunately we don't have any kind of institute recognized good institution, I mean, there is coming up. I can see some of the private institutions are coming up with good technological education, which will bring youth or at least in middle-aged people to acquire skills and get into the workforce and make contribution for the high economic growth. I think this is another important, those are the areas that I would highlight. What are the kind of pillars that would need for the economy to grow at a high? It's like a building a house, so that we have foundation. Now you build all these pillars so that you can grow at a faster. But it's important to remember, at any point, if you break the foundation, that is macroeconomic stability, again, this will broke up. And also, without those pillars, even if you have strong foundation, without those pillars, we can't grow at this 7%. I think this is where these accountants, accounting professionals, as I think good example was mentioned, for us, for you to have employment or gainful employment, you need to have, country need to have other sectors prospering. You can't do the accounting if there are no other business. So if construction sector booming, then you will have jobs. The tourism sector booming, you will have jobs. And on top of that, with the technology, and you will have less, you know, I mean, now what you 10 people are doing, in the future with all technology, one people may be able to do what all your 10 were doing. So this is a challenge, I think, even for professions like yours. Unless you bring up skills with technology and also skills that are globally competitive, if they can't work here, they should be able to go somewhere else and recognize qualification, and they should be able to work anywhere else in the world. I don't mind migration as long as we have a sufficient labor. And if you have right skills, people will come back. And this is what we need. And so this is, I think, the challenge, even for institutions like the CMA. And it's important that you identify the futures. Very impressive presentation that Professor from Singapore made. This is, identify the future skills, what you need, and prepare, have facilities to have a workforce prepared for that kind of skills. And other, this is the reason why people are coming, a lot of people are going abroad, students are going abroad to study and they don't come back. It's because we don't have opportunities here. If we have opportunities here, obviously there will be Sri Lankans, so youth will be willing to work here, willing to study here, and these are all structural issues. This one important point. And then I want to highlight other important point, and the second part of my speech is the role of professional accountants, especially when it comes to the period of political cycles, elections. This is where the sustainable development, as I mentioned, you need to maintain the fiscal consolidation, fiscal stability in terms of macroeconomic stability, in terms of lower fiscal deficits, less debt to GDP. Otherwise, we are going to break that foundation again. So that is where your role as professional accountants, whenever you see, especially when it comes to elections, the politicians will be, as you see in this culture of subsidies, social welfare, all these things. And whenever they say, okay, we will give public servants another 10,000 rupee or 50,000 rupee pricing, wealth salary increase, if you are going to more 40,000 graduates, and the question that you as professional accountants need to ask, from where you find the finance? How do you finance that? Without accountability, this is where integrated reporting is important. Anyone who will come up is saying, we'll have 600,000 more people, we'll give Samudri, a social security network. We'll get these people into the Samudri. Additional 40 billion rupees. We will increase salaries of the public servants by another 20,000 rupees. We'll give electricity, we will not increase the electricity prices. Then the question is that, how do you finance the electricity board if you don't reverse? If you are going to petrol diesel at a lower price, then the question, how do you finance that? It's all not government money, it's all your money. Either taxpayers like you, or even the beneficiaries are directly or indirectly will have to pay that. Government cannot have any money, but what they do is to reallocation, collect from some people and give it to someone else. So if any kind of a manifesto or anyone is promising, this is the culture of Sri Lanka we had. We'll give this thing, give this thing, give this thing. It's always the resources of accounting professionals to raise this question aware the general public. Okay, you will get electricity at a lower price, but either you as a taxpayer or you are in the future, unless you live here, you have to pay that, or your future generation will pay that. There's no way, there's nothing called free lunch. Whatever, I'm not saying those should not be given. Those social welfare systems should be there. But the one example is that I got some numbers today in the morning. We have what they call social safety net. I think we have, in terms of numbers, we have 1.3 million families getting social safety net members. Now it has increased 1.9 million people, which is about 1.4 members per family. This is about 7.6 million people. That's upon the population. Is 35% population are eligible to have this social government subsidy? But in the statistics, our poverty is only less than 6%. What is this mismatch? So we have people living below under poverty, only 6% of people, very low income people who are living, they deserve to have social safety net system. Even the pensioners or little people, they deserve to have social safety net. But we have 35% of population getting that. So what happens is basically because of the budget constraint, everyone getting peanuts. So 35% people who do not deserve, who are in high income brackets are also getting. And as a result, they deprive of the people who deserve to get this. This is untargeted. Politicians would like to increase the recipient numbers, but they would not like to target and facilitate people to move out of the social safety net and go to a high income bracket and have their own way of living through their income generation. So if that continues, then of course the question that you need to ask, if you're going to have more 600,000 people paying social safety net, that's fine. If they are deserved, that's okay. Then who is going to pay that bill? People who are getting that bill, indirectly they are paying larger part in terms of indirect taxes. And then you taxpayers, income taxpayers, are paying. And then also some of the provisions I have seen, now the taxes are very high in this country, and tax revenue has gone up from 1 trillion to 2 trillion, and we will bring down. So then the question is that if tax revenues of government are going to bring down, from where you cut the expenditure? Are you going to reduce the public sector wages? Going to not recruit people into the government? These are the valid questions any professional accountant should ask. There's a lack of awareness in this country about the accountability of the real allocation of public funds, the taxpayers' money. Or even what you borrow, what the government borrowing means, that is future taxpayers' money, that you, what you borrow today, the government borrow, will have to be paid in terms of next year tax or next generation tax. So that's all future liabilities. This is where I think the responsibility of this, why I'm talking about the role of professional accountants, and this is I have not seen a sufficient discussion among the professionals, especially the professionals like accountants, to raise this question, and where are the general public of these kind of things that is going to break the macroeconomic stability in terms of fiscal or in terms of current account. If there's anything that's going to break that thing. So someone can, I will give you 200,000 houses, 2 million houses to everyone. Then the question immediately asks, who is going to pay for that? So likewise, I think that is the important responsibility for that's what I want to emphasize here. And have some awareness and highlight the need for that kind of accountability and the awareness among the general public so that will be good for the country. Thank you very much.